முக்கியமான ஒரு கிளாஸ் பட் இட் இஸ் ட்ரை டு அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் திஸ் கான்செப்ட் வெரி கிளியர்லி இந்த ஃபர்ஸ்ட் யூனிட் இன்ஃபேக்ட் வி லேர்ன்ட் அபவுட் எம்பி மாடல்ஸ் நெக்ரோஸ்பிக்ஸ் மாடல் பெர்செப்ட்ரான் நெட்வொர்க் அண்ட் தென் இந்த பெர்செப்ட்ரான் லேர்னிங் வி லேர்ன்ட் அபவுட் திஸ் டபிள்யூ பிளஸ் எக்ஸ் டபிள்யூ மைனஸ் எக்ஸ் பேஸ்ட் லேர்னிங் அண்ட் தென் வி லேர்ன்ட் அபவுட் டெல்டா ரூல் ஆர் த வெரி ஃபேமஸ் கிரேடியன்ட் டிசன்ட் ரூல் Okay, the gradient descent rule, when you are going to extend it for multi-layered perceptron, you call it as the back-propagation learning network. In fact, we have to learn this. Okay, so this will, it will take, to take two or three classes. You'll understand it very clearly, back-propagation. But before that, I'll be introducing you the topic, Hebbian learning. Okay, so the first unit, it is also there, is Hebbian learning rule. So Hebbian learning rule, there is a good connection you can see between this W plus X, W minus X, na? These two are related. Okay. So let us try to understand this concept in a very clear way. So I am expecting you to interact with me when I am discussing this concept. So please read this statement very clearly. This is a very famous statement uttered by Hebb, which in fact changes the entire machine learning domain. Okay, because his learning rule is a key. By 1949, he uttered this statement after studying the neurons in the body. Okay, so if you read this statement, it's very clearly mentioned that when an axon of cell A, okay, this is the cell A, for example, here you have cell A, and an axon, okay, through that the signal passes. When an axon of cell A is near enough to excite a cell B, this is cell B. There are two cells, they are connected somewhat very close to each other, and this cell, okay, when the axon of the cell A is very near to the excite a cell B, what happens? And repeatedly or persistently takes part in firing. Okay, this A is influencing this B, remember that. And repeatedly or persistently takes part in firing A, some growth process or metabolic change, this is the key there, takes place in one or both the cells such that A's efficiency, okay, in as one of the cells firing B is increased. So the key idea, did you understand? Can somebody tell me what you understood from this statement? What is that, in fact, you're trying to infer from this? Anybody from the class? Some kind of metabolic change he's trying to talk about. Okay, some growth process or metabolic change takes place in one or both cells such that A's efficiency is one of the cells firing B is going to get. You understand? So we have two cells, cell A and I have cell B. So this cell is now going to, this axon, it doesn't matter. Okay? So the efficiency of cell A, okay, in firing cell B is going to get increased. Means then there will be some kind of metabolic change happens between them. Metabolic change or some kind of, what is that? Or metabolic change or growth process is what he is saying. Some growth process takes place. Okay, some growth process takes place. It's more like that. Imagine, so for example, cell A at one point of time, let us imagine it's firing. Okay, it's going high, cell A. This is cell A, this is the axon of cell A. And when it is going high, it is in fact, we are noticing that cell B also goes high. It also fires. So, and every time, okay, you are seeing in a very frequent manner, you are seeing that every time this cell A fires, you are noticing that cell B also fires. Then what will be your conclusion? Every time when cell A fires, you are seeing cell B also fire. See, imagine cell B is not only receiving input only from A, it may also receive input from other neurons also. Remember that. But still, you are noticing that out of around 1,000 times, around 990 times, okay, whenever cell A fires, cell B also fires. It means that there is a kind of some metabolic change happening between these two cells, okay. So, and thereby, there is some kind of growth process takes place. Thereby, the efficiency of cell A in firing cell B is getting increased. Okay, over a period of time, when this event happens again and again and again, there may be a kind of metabolic change that can happen between these two cells. And thereby, the efficiency of cell A in firing cell B is going to become higher. So what you are understanding from this? Can somebody repeat what I said? Anyone? Is it clear what I said? Imagine I have a cell, neuron cell. This is my neuron, this is my axon. This is very near, okay, to another neuron. We have a dendrite of this neuron, very near. And you are seeing this neuron going high. Same time you are seeing this also goes high. If this is going to happen, again and again and again, it is said that there can be a metabolic change that can happen between these two cells, or otherwise a growth process can happen between these two cells in such a fashion that the efficiency of this cell A in firing this B spiral, yeah, is going to get increased. Because of what? This kind of metabolic change or growth process. Okay, so that's the idea. So with that in mind, now let us move ahead and try to get into how we can formulate a kind of a learning rule based on it. So we already learned about something called a pure linear function like this. Okay, pure linear function like this. A pure linear, passing through the origin. Okay. So whatever that comes here, okay, the output A is nothing but W times the input. Okay, so that's a kind of pure linear function. So whatever input is here, whatever this n is, A is going to be, if this is 1, if this is 2, this is 2. So this is n. What is n? N is equal to W. So naturally, A is equal to W. Okay, there's some kind of weight. And so this is WP, don't get confused. It is more like an inner product, okay, between the patterns and this. Okay, that's what it is written. Wij, Pj. Okay, that's this matrix. That is linear combinations. Okay, linear combination. So it's nothing but what are they? W11 P1 plus W12 P2. That's what this. Okay. So naturally the training set is like this. So this you call it as the linear associative. Why it's called associative? You know what? Why it is associative? It's called. Why it's called associative? Anyone from the class? Am I audible? Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible, sir.
Yeah. Now, can you tell me why it is called associative, linear associative?
Because
it
associates two neurons.
Yeah, the output A is associated with the input because it's linearly proportional. Okay, you understand the point clearly. It's a linear combination. So naturally, there is a kind of an association between the input and output. Now look at our case, what we have been discussing so far. So I am talking about an association here also, okay, between the firing of this neuron with the firing of this neuron. So whenever B fires, there is always a chance that B is firing primarily because of A firing. Okay, that's what I am talking about, this metabolic change. Okay, there can be a metabolic change or a growth process happening between these two neurons. Okay. Because of that, every time when this neuron goes high, there is a possibility that because A firing, B is also firing. Okay, there is a possibility. Okay, that's what this statement is in fact saying. The statement is saying that A is efficiency. Okay, what is that statement? A is efficiency in firing, is it not? A is efficiency as one of the cells firing B is increased. Okay, one of the cells. That's the another one key point. There may be many other cells also which may be helping B to fire. But A's efficiency is going to increase. How it is going to get increased? Because of this metabolic change. So can we do it in a mathematical way, that one? If we are going to do it in a mathematical way, this metabolic change, how can we increase or decrease? What we can do for that? Can you guess something? Mathematically, how we can increase or decrease that metabolic change? Can you guess something?
By increasing and decreasing the weight.
And that's good. Excellent. That's the idea. So then you got the idea very clear. So we are going to increase or decrease the weight in such a fashion that if there is a strong association, the weights are going to get increased. If there is no association, the weights are going to go down. Okay, that's the idea with which Hebbian learning group really functions. Now look at this Hebbian group. Can you see it clearly? This is a postsynaptic signal. Postsynaptic signal means I'm talking about this one. What is that? This one. This is a postsynaptic signal. The synapse, this is a synapse we told. Okay, we already discussed about neurons. This is a postsynaptic. This is the what? We enrolled, this is a postsynaptic and this is a presynaptic. Okay, so I'm telling in a reverse way. Okay, so this is the postsynaptic. This is a postsynaptic and this is a presynaptic. Presynaptic. So whenever, see, this presynaptic output is high and this is also high, then what do you do with the weights? The presynaptic value is high, postsynaptic value is high. What do you do for the weights? Weight has to be increased. Okay, that's our goal. That's what I said by the growth process. Growth process or some metabolic change happening, which strengthens the relationship. So every time this A fires, B has to fire. So naturally, I'm looking at this presynaptic signal and postsynaptic signal like this. Okay. So now look at the case, the weight, rule. Okay, this was the postsynaptic and this is the presynaptic. In a very simplified form, it is like this. Okay, this is a, it's called the unsupervised mode of learning. We are not going to give any target here. Simply, we are feeding some input to a neuron, okay? Some A, and we are going to take some summation and all. We are going to get some output. The output here is, for A, this is P. Okay, P is a pattern input and A is a. So these are all the inputs I'm going to give and these are all the outputs I'm going to collect. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to, initially I'll give one pattern, okay? And then I look at the corresponding output. So I'll give the same pattern for a set of neurons. Imagine, like that. Give the same pattern to three neurons, like this. Same pattern, P1. I assign some random weights. Here, some random weights. Here, some random weights. Here, some. And out of these three neurons, for the given pattern, based on the weights, one of them will fire. Okay, one of them will go a little high. Imagine that. Then what do you do? The next iteration, if these two are low, these weights are going to go down in the next iteration, and this weight is going to go up. That's idea. Okay. So naturally, because this one is fired for the given pattern, so naturally, I'm going to strengthen that weight. So that when the weight is being increased, okay, like this, because they are pointing in the same direction, imagine this. You can easily imagine this. So you can imagine that this is 1, 0, A. If P is 0, 1, if they are orthogonal, whether the weights will increase? Do you understand the question? Definitely not. You understand? Because they are orthogonal. We are going to take the product, then value becomes zero, weights are not going to get increased. So when the input pattern and the output pattern, they are mutually orthogonal, okay, then the weights will not be increased, okay, and thereby there won't be any learning happen. Okay, so if the input pattern and the output pattern, they are going to point in the same direction, that means the weight is going to get increased. Okay, the new weight is good. It means I'm strengthening the relationship. Okay, for that particular pattern. So every time that particular pattern comes, that particular set of weights are going to go high, and because of that, but that particular neuron is going to go give a higher. Okay, and the rest of the neurons' values are going to be low. So it's meaning that. Okay, you understand the point? Can you visualize it clearly? Let me repeat.
Sir, can you repeat, sir?
Yeah. So listen this carefully. So we are talking about two neurons. Let's imagine I have a neuron here, I have another neuron, okay, I have another neuron, three neurons. Okay, so let us imagine based on our perceptron method and all whatever you have learned, okay, I got three separate neurons, imagine this. So I am giving a pattern P1 here, I am giving the same pattern P1 here, I am giving the same pattern. For understanding purpose, I am telling you this, okay. So I got three outputs, Y1, Y2. For the same pattern, So these weights are randomized, randomly picked. Okay, I got three set of weights, W1 for these three neurons, W2 for these three neurons. Now, when I'm going to feed this P1, out of these three neurons, one of the neurons will give comparatively higher output, you agree, than these two neurons. For example, imagine this, O1 is giving now higher output than these two neurons. Immediately what I do is, I will update this weight in such a fashion that these weights are going to get increased, so that every time this pattern comes, the output will be in a position to associate with this pattern. It's going to go high. Okay. So every time when this Y1 goes high, then I will associate in my mind, the input can be of this type, this kind of pattern P1 type. Okay. In the same mode, I can update for a different pattern P2. I will notice that these three neurons, this Y2 may go high. Then what do? I will update these weights for this pattern in such a fashion that every time this pattern comes, this neuron will go high. So whenever I'm going to see the output of a neuron, okay, with the three outputs, Y1, Y2, Y3, if Y3 goes up, I will be associating the corresponding pattern. What kind of pattern I could have given here? I will be associating. Okay, that's kind of learning you call it as the unsupervised mode of learning. Because here we are not giving any particular target at all. We are allowing the network to evolve and learn on its own by applying the Hebbian learning, by updating the weights based on the kind of relationship, Hebbian relationship. Okay, so are you getting the point, what I'm saying? Can I repeat?
So yeah. You are mapping each output to particular inputs.
Yeah, that's all. We are mapping. But in that process, the neuron, we are allowing it to learn. We are learning, we are allowing this to learn in such a fashion that, what is that learning rule? It states that, clearly understand this idea. How we are going to train our network is mu weight is equal to old weight as, okay, the output of the neuron, let us take it as A and the input as B. Okay, these two are vectors. So when this is the case, okay, if the output is high and the input is also the input vector and the output vector, if they are pointing the same direction, then this will go high. Okay, you understand? So thereby I am allowing for the given pattern, whatever high output I'm going to get here, I'm going to multiply that with this, and that value will definitely be a higher value. So naturally that weight is going to get increased. But the rest of the two neurons, they are going to have low value output. So naturally, when I'm going to multiply with that pattern, that's going to be a low weight. So these two weights are going to go down over a period of time. Frequently, I'm going to give a similar kind of data to the system and thereby allow the system to get trained for recognizing one particular pattern. That's the idea. Okay, so now look at the case. So that's what, in fact, we are doing here. See here, supervised form also, I can do it. Instead of A output, I can give my desired target also. So Hebbian learning rule, you can apply both in unsupervised mode as well as in supervised mode also. If it is a target given, naturally the point is T into P. P is the input pattern, target is T. So you multiply and update the weight. Okay, I'm going to have this kind of a relationship. Okay, an inner product relationship like this. If you look at this, sir, then my weight, yeah.
Sir, one doubt, sir. Could you please scroll up, sir?
Yeah.
A little bit.
Yeah.
So here in a simplified form, that is actually unsupervised mode, no, sir.
Which one?
Simplified form.
This one.
First one, yeah. The above that.
This is unsupervised, exactly. Simplified.
Unsupervised means there won't be input.
Any labels at all? No output at all for you initially. Targets are not being given to you. Okay. But what you are doing is you are randomly picking up a pattern, for example P1, and you have a set of neurons. Okay. You understand what I'm saying? So each neuron is randomly given some weights. Okay, and based on this relationship, that means what? That our relationship. What is that? WIXI. It is greater than some threshold, and all those values you have learned. Now, out of these three, any one may go up. Yeah, slightly higher value, for example, than these two, for example, initially for the given pattern. Then what do I do is, I will take that output, whatever I'm getting, I will multiply with this pattern and I'll update the weight accordingly. It means that I'm trying to get an output which is going to be oriented more towards the pattern P. That's the idea.
How do you choose that, sir?
Huh?
Is it completely random or?
The weights are random. The weights are random. Okay, initially to start.
The particular P1 is we choose that, sir.
Yeah, this P1 we'll choose from the data set. We don't know which particular class they belong to or which particular pattern they belong to. Okay, we choose some randomly, we'll give some values. Okay. And thereby group it. And over a period of time, whenever we recognize the output, this particular neuron fires, then we'll be associating that output with the input. Well, let us see. Fully we'll understand when you go through the problems and all. Okay. Just right now think about this a bit. Okay, this is a supervised mode wherein the instead of A, I'm going to give the target, and in the matrix form it's going to be like this. Okay, so in that case, the weights are going to be rated. Zero initial weights, zero initial weight is zero. My weights are going to look like this. This is target one, P1 transpose. Target two, P2 transpose. So it's going to look more like this. Okay, so the matrix form is going to be, when you take a problem, you understand. So this is your weight. So immediately what I can do, I can compute my weights once the targets and the patterns are given to me. I can compute in one go, in one mathematical step, I can compute my weights immediately. That's the power of this Hebbian ring. Now look at this performance analysis. So what is the output of the neuron? Output of the neuron is W times the inputs, okay, matrix. So naturally, if these weights are going to be like this, Q equal to 1, 2, Q, PQ, PQ, transpose, the weights are going to be like this, then PK I'm going to multiply. So naturally, I'm going to get this relationship, PQ transpose, PK. Okay, so if the input patterns are orthogonal to each other, so that's where the problem is. That's where the advantage is. If the input patterns are orthogonal to each other, so I have pattern P1, which is like this. Okay, I have another pattern P2, which is like this. If they are orthogonal. And if I multiply these two dot product, if I take this, if I take the product, what do I get? I'll get zero immediately. Okay. If they are pointing the same, if Q is equal to K, if both are same, what do I get? 100, 100. I'm going to get the value 1. If they are orthonormal, okay, that's important. Orthogonal and orthonormal. I'm going to get 1. So this should be orthonormal. Okay, they are 100, 100. So if I multiply that, I'm going to get 1. So if they are orthogonal, I'm going to get 0. Okay, you understand the point. So therefore, the network, if the patterns or input patterns are orthogonal, what will be the output of the neuron then? A is going to be equal to WPK. That's nothing but this value is 1. Therefore, it's going to be TK, target. You understand? So whenever I'm going to feed a particular P, I'm going to get my corresponding target immediately. PK, I'm going to get target TK immediately. But, okay, but the input patterns are normalized, but not orthogonal. They are not orthogonal. What's going to happen? Definitely, you're going to get this error. Primarily because you are going to have WPK. WPK is nothing but what? PQ, PQ transpose PK. Okay. So then you are going to get this value. PQ, PQ transpose PK. This PQ will be there for particular value. So this kind of an error you'll be getting because the corresponding PK is not matched exactly with the target. So somehow you'll be getting this error. So now look at this case. If you have got a two patterns, P1. Are you getting the point clearly? This slide, anyone having difficulty in understanding it? What is it I'm trying to convey from this slide? Can somebody put it in words? Guru Bharat, Varsha? Anyone from the class?
Sir, using this particular yes. model, we can we should give, like, if we give the input and the target, sir, we can yeah. calculate the weights.
Yeah, we're using this relation. Okay. Simply, it's more like an inner product between the target and the input pattern. That's all. Is it right? Okay. Now, then what is your understanding?
After that it should be orthogonal, sir.
Yeah. What is the point? How do you understand that? See here. This is your input P. Okay. This is your weight This is your output neuron. This is the output of the neuron. So the output of the neuron is nothing but weight into pattern. You agree? You agree?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So then weight, how you are computed? Like this. You are computed the weight like this. You agree?
Yes, sir.
So then Q varying from 1 to Q means how many part, whatever may be the number of patterns you have, that's what this. Q equal to 1 to Q. P1, yes. P2 like. Now you are multiplying with PQ. If you look at that case, this PQ and this PK, what are they? They are the patterns. P1, P2 like. If these patterns are mutually orthogonal and orthonormal, okay, unit vectors, they are all. In that case, what happens? When Q is not equal to K, two different vectors you are going to take, and you take the dot product, it's going to become 0. You agree? You agree? Yeah. 1, 0, 0, yes, 0, 1, 0, if you take the dot product, it's going to be 0. If they are one and the same, what do you get? You get 1. Orthonormal. Q equal to K. Okay, you agree?
Sir, then you selectively filter out the input should give the target, sir. Are you doing that?
No, we are in fact, what we are doing is, we are trying to map for the given pattern P1, okay, what's the corresponding target T1. For the given pattern P2, what's the corresponding target P2? That we are achieving it by using the weights, okay? That weights is computed like this. This will work only when these patterns are all mutually orthonormal to each other. Then only you are going to get the output as A into WPK is equal to TK. Primarily because this value becomes 1. For the given PQ transpose PK, this will become 1 when Q is equal to K. I'm going to get my target TK out for the given PK. Are you seeing the point clearly what I'm saying?
Sir, could you repeat, sir?
No, look at this case. See, for example, I'm giving the pattern PK. What is that I'm expecting output? I'm expecting TK. Okay, but what I have got here, I got this expression. This expression will become 1 when Q is equal to K. You agree? Because this relation PK, PQ transpose PK is equal to 1.
When
these two are orthonormal to each other, I'm going to get Q equal to K, I'm going to get 1.
So naturally, that is when the inputs are same.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Okay, then that Q equal to K means I'm going to get TK here. If not, if the patterns are not orthogonal and orthonormal, it's not orthogonal, I'm going to end up with this particular error pattern. Okay, so that's what here is conveying. Okay, he's conveying this error. I'm going to get TK definitely, but plus additionally, I'm going to have some more values, Q not equal to K also, some values, because Q not equal to K is not 0, no more 0 here.
Okay.
Because they are not orthogonal. If Q is not equal to K,
Q equal to K is a perfect condition, Q not equal to K is a error.
Q not equal to K, when it will happen?
When the inputs are not same as the
data. They are not orthogonal. The patterns are not orthogonal to each other, I'm going to get
that is when the patterns are not same.
Yeah, even if I give a PK as input, I will not be getting TK directly as output. Along with that, I'll get some errors. But the error is calculated like this. But if they're orthogonal and orthonormal, I'll get PK, I'll get TK immediately. No trouble at all. Are you getting the point?
Okay, sir.
So naturally, somehow or other, we need to look at finding out what you call take the patterns, okay, and orthonormalize it through some linear algebraic technique. Okay, there is a method called Gram-Schmidt algorithm in linear algebra, numerical linear algebra. If you give different patterns of vectors, P1, P2, different vectors you give, and if they are not orthogonal, and if you want to make it to orthogonal, okay, through a projection idea, this is called a Gram-Schmidt linear algebraic
technique. Sir, would you go to the previous one, sir?
Yeah.
Yes. Sir, here, one second, sir.
Please. Try to understand this idea. It's an important idea.
Sir, here, it's given that when Q is not equal to K, it's 0, no, sir?
Yeah, that's right.
Then in the second case, it shouldn't it be 0?
Yes, sir, that one. The first point you have to understand here is, I'm talking about input patterns or orthogonal. And this case is not orthogonal. Only for orthogonality, this condition holds true. When Q is not equal, two patterns. This is Q, this is K, man. These two are not equal. 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. So when I'm multiplying this, what do I get? I get 0. If they are not orthogonal, I will end up in this error. Because when the multiplication of this will not get you 0. You understand? I get this error.
Okay.
Okay, the patterns are not orthogonal, I'm going to land up in error.
So then what do you mean by normalized?
Normalized means unit vectors. See, for example, I have a vector like 1, 0, 0. If I take the length of this vector, it's going to be 1 square plus 0 square plus 0 square. I'm going to get 1. So this is the vector length. Okay, so along the three axis, x, y, z, and this vector is pointing in this direction. Okay, and this vector is pointing in this direction. These two are unit vectors. So they are orthogonal, 90 degree, as well as they are normalized to 1. Vector length is 1. You understand? Okay. So if they are orthonormalized, then you get them exactly. Okay, this is called orthonormal vectors.
So then if two inputs are having the same...
What?
If two patterns are having the same value, can they be called normalized, or should they be unit vectors?
No, two patterns, for example, if they are there, okay, for example, 2, 3, 5, I can normalize 2 equal to 1. How do I do it? Take the square root of all these, okay, get the value, and divide each value by this number, this length. Then I'll be getting a vector, which is nothing but a normalized unit vector. Are you getting the point what I'm saying? For example, okay. 1, 2, 3, this vector. What is the length of this vector? 1 square plus 2 square plus 3 square. Okay, that is going to be 1 plus 4 plus 9. Okay, it's going to be around 14. Square root of 14. Now, this vector, whether it is a unit vector, not. No. But I can normalize it to 1 by square root of 14, 2 by square root of 14, 3 by square root of 14. If I take the length of this vector, this will be 1. You understand? Normalize it, the vectors.
Okay, sir.
So if they are unit vectors and they are orthogonal, then you call it as orthonormal. Normalized to 1 and they are unit vectors. Understand?
Yes, sir.
So the problem comes when you are talking about non-orthogonality. So look at this case. I have a pattern minus 1, 1 minus 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay. Now for this pattern, I have normalized it. So what I have done here is 1 square root of 1 square plus 1 square plus 1 square. So it will be square root of 3. So divide minus 1 by square root of 3. I'll be getting this value. Minus 0.577. You understand? So I have normalized this vector into a unit vector like this. And I have normalized this vector into a unit vector like this. Target is minus 1. Target is plus 1. Then how do we compute the weight? Take the target. The target is like this. And the P transpose.
So how are you deciding the target, sir?
See, it's a label data. This is label data.
Okay.
Label data. It's a supervised mode. So target is given to you. For this pattern, give minus one. This pattern, give 1. That's all. Okay, this is apple, this is banana. Okay. Can you see it? I want to separate these two classes. You getting the point?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes,
sir. Now you compute your TP transpose comfortably like this. Okay. So this is P1 transpose is put up like this. This is P1. This is P1 transpose. This is P2 transpose. So you can multiply these two. I'm going to get this weight. So can you see it now? Can you see the neuron clearly now? The neuron is going to be like 3 inputs. This is pattern P1. So I'm going to give all the 3 values. The weights are P1, W2. So I have computed the weight. Okay. That's what this idea is. Okay, I computed 1.15480. So when I give WP1, immediately I'm getting minus 0.06. Okay, that's output. And that's for this case, I'm getting 0.668. Okay, so now you can find out the performance index like this. Okay, WPK equal to 2Q. So I'm going to take TQ. And WPQ is the neural output, same manner whatever we did, it's a target. So W matrix form of the WP is equal to target, that's the form. Therefore, I'm going to put like this, the E square, the error. Okay, T minus WP. Then what I can do is, if WP equal to T, and I'm going to minimize this, if an inverse exists for P, okay, I can immediately compute the weight. How? T. WP is equal to T. If I want weights, simply put TP. Okay, I get the weight immediately. If that is, when an inverse does not exist, we'll go for an idea called as pseudo inverse. can refer to linear algebraic book. Okay, pseudo inverse is like this. P transpose P is more like projecting all these values in some other element to work out. Okay, you can understand this by reading a good linear. If you want, maybe I will teach you on this also. Pseudo inverse. Quite easy idea, not a very difficult. Okay, orthogonality and the projections idea. So P transpose P inverse, P transpose is what I'll be. So the Hebb rule is more like this. If it is going to be orthonormal pattern vectors, the rule is very easy. W is equal to T P transpose. Because in the orthonormal procedure, P inverse is equal to P transpose. This one condition. Okay, the vectors are orthonormal. Orthonormal means what? Unit vectors plus orthogonal. So naturally, if I want to compute the weights, I can do this. Because we know that PW is equal to target. I want weight, which is nothing but T P inverse. But as they are orthonormal, they can be written as T P transpose. That's what it is. If the vector inverse is not existent, they are not orthogonal. The patterns are not orthogonal, then P inverse does not exist. Okay, then what do you do? W equal to T, yes, you write P transpose P inverse, P transpose, you write. Then in that case, you get this. Okay, they are orthonormal now, primarily because of this. Okay. Sorry, if the patterns are orthonormal, you are going to get P plus is equal to P transpose. That's what we have done already here. If they are not orthonormal, then you have to work out this by. Find out the pseudo inverse. You getting the point what I am saying? Is it clear? Somebody tell me what I said right now. 3 points. Number one, the patterns are orthonormal. If the patterns are orthonormal, it means they are unit vectors. They are unit vectors. As well as they are orthogonal to each other, the vectors. For example, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. You remember this. If they are like this, the vectors are like this, then it won't be a problem. Simply put, WP is equal to T, W is equal to TP transpose. Why P transpose instead of inverse? In the orthonormal case, you'll be getting this condition, P inverse equal to P transpose. Even if you transpose it, you're going to get the inverse immediately. Okay, in that way, we can compute the weights comfortably. But if they are not orthogonal, we need to go in for a condition P transpose P, the whole inverse P transpose. That is the pseudo inverse condition, wherein you go for some kind of orthonormalization process, okay, orthogonalization process, and then you work out. So then P transpose P equal to I, and that's all right, okay, because pseudo inverse will become pseudo P transpose when they are orthogonal, the vectors are orthogonal, okay, because the vectors, for example, P transpose P, if it is equal to identity matrix, it means P transpose is nothing but what P is. That's the meaning. You understand my point? For example, I got a 1, 0, 0, A, and I'm going to multiply this. This is 3 cross 1, this is 1 cross 3. I'm going to have a 1 cross 1 number. Okay, that's identity. So naturally, P transpose P is equal to, if there is a matrix, you can work out the same one. Okay, P transpose P equal to P inverse. You're getting the point, what I'm saying? Is it clear? Anybody having difficulty? Anything to be repeated? Now look at this case. P1 is given like this. P2 is like this. And now these two vectors, they are not orthogonal. Now I'm going to find out the pseudo inverse. The pseudo inverse is identified like this. Okay, P transpose P first. Okay, we have to use this target, we use P plus. P plus is computed like this. P transpose P inverse, P transpose. That's going to be. Okay. This value, if you look at this, here you can see that's P transpose P. Okay, this value. Okay, and this is P transpose. You can multiply and you can see this. This is P transpose. This vector is going to be. Two cross three, three cross. So I'll be getting two cross two matrix. That's one. Is it clear? So this P transpose is this. multiply this, I'm going to get P plus X. So once I get P plus, I put T and put T P plus, I'm going to have 1 0. And WP1 is going to have minus 1, and WP2 would have plus 1. So this is what I want. This class is different from this class. I want to have two different classes. So minus 1 plus 1 for the given weight. So but if you do the same problem without taking the pseudo inverse, using the previous approach like this. What is this approach? This approach. Simply put T into P transpose. You won't get the value. You won't get two separate classes like this, minus plus. Like this. You'll get a different class. So you can try that as a homework, okay? Pseudo inverse is very important. This P the whole inverse, P transpose is important. It's super important, this idea. Numerical linear algebra, they play an important role when it comes to machine learning. Okay, a lot of algebraic techniques, linear algebra techniques have been heavily employed, particularly when you learn techniques like PCA, principal component analysis, singular value decompositions. All these ideas have been heavily employed. Eigenvalues, eigenvectors, they all play a crucial role when it comes to machine learning. Okay, maybe we'll spend some time on that, but right now just get a feel of this, how we are doing this. So that's the idea. Now how we can employ this as an auto-associative model. So for that, so I got this data, P1, T1, P2, T2, P3, T3, okay, different values like this. So I'm going to train my network like this. So you see, what is the difference between this one and TP transpose between these two? Can you see a difference? What we are trying to do here? Anyone? What we did there? Can you recall?
So instead of multiplying with the target, they are multiplying with the pattern system.
That's called auto association. So the goal is more like this. Whenever I'm going to feed a particular pattern as input, the system output has to recall that pattern and should tell the same pattern. It's called auto associative. Okay, for example, if the input pattern is slightly distorted, noise, with the noise and corrupted, the network should be in a position to still recall that particular pattern, even though the input is corrupted. Imagine an image. I'm training a network with an image, a particular face image. Okay, I've trained my network to recognize a particular face image. Now I have obtained the same face, but with a lot of distortions. But the network, if it is in a position to recall that image, then it will be quite helpful to me. You understand? So it can recognize digits, it can recognize images, all this it can do. For example, this zero pattern is like this. Okay, for this zero pattern, the data is like this. What are these values? Can you recognize this? For example, the first value is 1, minus 1. Okay, for the white pixel, minus 1. All the black pixels taken in a column-wise manner. Column-wise. First one is 1, 1, 1, 1. The last value is minus 1 again. So the second column, 1, minus 1, minus 1. White pixels you have, minus 1, minus 1. And then again, black pixel. So I can represent this particular binary kind of an image with a zero representing inside in the form of a pattern like this, a column vector like this, with each one holding zero and ones. Okay, for a color image, I can do this, but with a three-dimensional matrix. Okay, I can do this in the same manner. For different colors, for RGB, I'll be fixing different values. For each pixel, I'll be fixing values. Okay, so but just for our understanding, let us take a binary image, and this minus one indicating this white region, one indicating black. Therefore, minus 1, 1, 1, 1, minus 1. That's the first column. I'm putting everything from one particular column. So one column, I'm putting all this. Okay, for all this. Entire data is represented in one. So this is a different pattern, and this is a different pattern. I got three patterns, P1, P2, P3. Now I'm training my network weight like this. Can somebody tell me what is the output? Every time when I feed P1, okay, I'm going to get P1 as output. Because that's what we learned, W is equal to TP transpose. So if the weights are orthonormalized and orthogonal, I'm going to get W is equal to target T. Okay, see, output of the neuron is going to be equal to target T based on this W. That's what we learned. So I'm going to train my network so that whenever I feed pattern P1, I'm going to get pattern P1 as output. But when this P1 is distorted like this, okay, 67% occulted. Occulted means somewhat distorted, hidden inside. Data is hidden, the image is hidden inside. So in that case, I'm going to have a different value. So still with these variations, I'll be in a position to recollect the data. I can recognize the data with this particular training. This W is equal to P1, P1 transpose, P2 equal to P2 transpose, P3 equal to P3 transpose. I can train my network. So these are the variations of this rule, a basic rule. You'll see that example. By taking up a tutorial problem, you can understand this. Here's how we are going to do this. See here, gradually the data is computed.
Sir,
yeah.
So now in that, what do you say, this display example, sir. Starting you gave one value, so P1, and it's displaying 0.
Where?
You know, the value given out,
yeah, yeah, P1, yeah, that's
this column vector,
yeah, yeah.
It is displaying 0.
Yeah.
Then what learning is?
No. You know, it is something you have to understand. Like it's called auto-associative memory. See, it's kind of memory. Okay, for example, imagine you have gone to a particular place in some tourist spot. Okay. So you have visited the place and you have seen some landmarks there. Okay, you've seen some landmarks. Then after 10 years, okay, you are seeing a particular landmark like that, what you have seen 10 years back. So immediately in your memory, you will recall that place. You agree?
Yes, sir.
You recall that place. That's called associative, they call it. This kind of memory, they call it associative memory. You might not have seen completely that particular place, but you have seen only a portion of that particular place. You agree? A particular landmark only you are now seeing after 10 years. But still you can recollect that entire image in your mind. Oh, that place I visited that day, that falls was there, that hotel was there. So many things you remember. You agree?
Yes, sir.
In the same manner, what we are trying to do is, we are trying to create a network, a neural network, which can have something called an auto-associative memory. Okay, so that you are training the network to recognize a particular pattern. Now, what happens? Due to some distortion, this original image is now corrupted. Okay, and now that network, after getting trained, it is going to receive this as a test signal. Now that network can associate still, okay, with this 0, and you can immediately recall that 0 output for you. It is very useful when it comes to communication networks, okay, image recognition techniques and all these things. Okay, you train the network with labeled data, okay?
Oh, so then, first you give P1, you'll get 0 as output, and if you give partial input next time,
the whole output will come, yeah, that's the advantage.
Oh, okay, sir.
That way, in fact, you can gain a lot, okay, even with very limited data, you'll be uncertain data, as they call it. With very limited uncertain data, you'll be in a position to reconstruct your image back. That's very powerful.
Okay.
So communication network and all, you'll be knowing that. So you can reconstruct the signals and all those things you can do. Signal processing applications are there for auto encoders. Okay. Adaptive filtering and all those techniques are there. But it's very powerful. But the idea is very simple, is it not? Hebbian learning is very simple. You simply take the product of this, P1, P1 transpose, that's all. You get the weights. Okay. So variations of Hebbian learning is like this. So it's a basic rule. What is this? This is labeled. Labeled. Supervised. Okay. Learning rate can be adjusted. That is also there. So why do we need to learn? See, you get the output initially, then again and again you update the weights so that these two will become exactly exactly pointing the same direction. P and PQ. Then only you get a maximum output. It's more kind of weight. See, if the problem comes, the weight normally gets saturated. You keep updating the weights. Okay. So if they're going to point in the same direction, you get a huge value for this. And thereby the weight may get updated, saturated. There is a possibility. The problem is there. Okay, Hebbian learning. So the learning rate can be adjusted. And smoothing can be done. Can you visualize this idea? This is adaptive filtering technique. Smoothing. Can you see this? What is the point here? Can somebody tell me what we are trying to do here? Look at this. I'm updating definitely the weights based on this TQPQ. Along with it, I'm introducing a term. Some fraction of this W. Why I'm doing it? Can somebody recall and tell me why we are doing it? It's more like forgetting factor. Forgetting factor. I don't want to update the weights for a very old pattern, the data which been trained long time back. I would like to update the weight for the fresh patterns, okay, for the recent data. So naturally, the old weights are not being given that much weightage. So I can reduce this value from the old weight so that I'll be updating my, so it's more like forgetting the old weight. Because otherwise, you get weight may get saturated. As I told you here, you keep updating the weights, the weight may get saturated in a period of time. So I don't want to do that. So I want to forget the old weights by including this gamma factor, okay? So thereby, this old weight is going to get subtracted out, and I'll always be updated. Okay, updated weight will be updated. It's called forgetting factor in the adaptive filtering technique literature. Okay, forgetting factor they call it, 1 minus gamma. Okay. So then delta rule is the same. Can you see delta rule here? Can you see this Hebbian learning rule is connected to our delta rule, gradient descent rule, what we have learned? Somewhat, okay, delta rule is this. PQ minus AQ, target minus the neural network output you are getting. But here what you are doing, simply multiply. That's the only change. So you can see the change.
Sir, in the gamma on the weight decay.
Weight decay. Forgetting factor.
Okay.
It's a hyperparameter. You can tune it. Okay. This hyperparameter means what? Parameters that are used in neural network which you can tweak. So you'll get different performances. They are the hyperparameters they call it. For example, learning rate can be a hyperparameter. This gamma can be a hyperparameter. You can tweak all these values to get a better results. Okay. So it's the decaying factor. Gradually it decays out. The old values will get the decays out. New value will be given higher weightage. That's the idea. Understand here that value here. When you go for more number of iterations, this value is going to become more and bigger and bigger. The older values automatically will get a decay. Okay. Now, unsupervised learning also you can do. So, there is a connection you can see between gradient descent, what we have learned, and this Hebbian learning. Okay. It is TQ, PQ, this is TQ minus AQ, PQ. AQ is what? Neural network output. TQ is what? The target. So finding the error and then updating. That's the only difference. Delta rule and Hebbian learning. Unsupervised learning, Hebbian learning is like this. You will not be knowing the target. Only with neuronal output, you are updating the weight parameter. Before anything you want me to discuss again, this particular topic, a super important topic, you can expect a question in the exam. Okay, so go through it. Get some problems also. Pseudo inverse and learn for 2x2 matrix. That's enough. Okay, inverse, how to find inverse of a 2x2 matrix, how to scale it, how to work out this problem. Okay, and you should also know the algorithm, how to write an algorithm for it. And if it is work out here, Python code or MATLAB code. Python and MATLAB code, you can get it from GitHub. NN design book, you can refer to. NN Design, they have a separate GitHub website. You can go through that also. Okay, NN Design. GitHub website is there. They have worked out a lot of Python code, MATLAB codes for all these problems. You can run all those codes and you can see the results also. It will be very interesting. Okay, so spend some time, learn all these ideas. See, we are going at a very slow pace. We learn one algorithm. Okay, for example, for Cepron means what we are trying to do, we are hand calculations we are trying to do. Okay, and then a code, we're trying to run a code. The same manner, Hebbian, we have to do a hand calculation and we have to run a code. So in this way, your ideas and concepts will become somewhat clear. And over a period of time, you gain confidence by working, practicing regularly. You'll gain confidence and you can work out a project. That's what our goal is. Okay, developing a project using some for a small data set, running a code and explaining what's happening and how to present it. All these things we are trying to do. So, all right, can I stop now? Any doubt? Anything? Balaji? I'll stop it.